1981 to leave teaching and go full-time into politics. I ran political campaigns for the Democratic Party. I put 5 people in the California State Assembly during that process. By 1984, I was getting burned out because people who work in politics essentially work about 19 to 20 hours a day with practically no sleep. And so I decided to get out of politics. And so I took a completely wild turn and moved to Nevada and ran a casino for 2 years, which is rather interesting for a college professor, particularly in the outlying counties of Nevada, where not only do you have gambling, but you also have legalized prostitution, which led to some rather interesting business arrangements that I had to be involved in while I was doing that. 2 years after that, I moved back to Los Angeles and worked on a leveraged buyout of a major corporation. Some of you may remember a company called Pioneer Takeout, which was a chicken chain. I was the executive vice president for 2 years. And then came back here to really get out of politics and work full-time in doing economic consulting, which is what I do today. So I'm an economic consultant, though I occasionally still do a little bit in politics, just simply because a lot of my work involves being involved in policy controversies where I'm working with members of the legislature, members of city councils, on a whole variety of issues. Now, what I thought I'd do for you today is treat you as if you were major business leaders in the Inland Empire, and what I'm going to show you is the kind of briefing I give them. As I talk about this stuff, and I've just put it on the computer here, so this will be available to your professor. As I talk about it, if you have a question, don't be afraid to stop me, because I can get pretty wound up when I do this stuff. But first of all, how many of you are freshmen? And how many are sophomores? And how many declined to stay? All right. Now, you live in an economy, and that economy has been very controversial for quite a long time. About 7 years ago, when I was giving speeches, we were down feeling like this. This is a psychological profile of a business cycle. So what were we? We were really depressed. We had gone into the worst recession since the Great Depression. In fact, the year I was born, which was 1941, was the last year of the Great Depression. So I am very, very old. Actually, they invented the wheel that year. The fact is that at that point, I went through about 4 years of giving this briefing, which changes virtually weekly. But I was regarded as the most depressing person anybody had to be in a room with. My wife Deborah and I, she complained to me one day that we were still not being invited to anybody's house because I'd walk in and immediately everybody'd be depressed. Well, you can see where I've got the arrow now. It's between excitement and thrill. So something has changed in the economy. The question is what and how can we think about it? The first place to look at that is in the national economy. Here's the Great Recession right here. All those negative bars, month after month, peeling off literally millions of jobs. Altogether, we lost 8.71 million jobs. Now you see here some really tall bars representing job growth. Don't get excited, that was hiring the census workers. Then we have 4 negative bars. That was laying them off after they'd done their work. After that, you see continual job growth for a very long period of time. The controversy has been that it's been too slow. Well, turns out this is now coming out to be an advantage. Why? Because the economy's not overheating. So what? Every time the economy gets going too fast, there is something that's going to go wrong. Last time it was housing. Any of you that own houses, or your parents own houses, or your grandparents own houses, the fact was those houses went down in value dramatically because of the craziness that went on in this period right in here. So by growing slowly, the economy has actually not gotten itself in trouble in that way, which is actually a good thing. So where are we today? We lost 8.71 million jobs in this period. In this period, we have gained back 12.4 million, or 42.5% more than we lost. So the fact is that we are way out of the hole nationally. We have record levels of employment in the country. If you listen to the Republican candidates debating, you would have no idea that was true. But the fact is, the economy is really in very good shape. In fact, right now, it is the strongest economy in the world. No one is really in the shape that we are. Now, there are two or three important metrics about the national economy that are important to understand. This is one of them. This is oil prices. You can see they're going along. This was the absolute record. That went up to about $135 a barrel. You'd see it collapse back in 09 with the recession, build back up, peak here at $105 a barrel, and then recently crash, and going down to about in the 40s. This spot, the most recent one, is just under $50 a barrel. Now, for most of the country, what that has meant is the price of petroleum shows up at the gasoline pump as much cheaper gasoline prices. That has not happened as much in this state. And I'll talk about that a little later on. But one of the things you will find out, as I used to be a Democratic campaign manager, today I am a registered independent, and I hate everybody. And it's largely the responsibility for the Democratic legislature that we have not seen the kind of gasoline prices in this state that are virtually everywhere else in the United States. I was just recently in Pennsylvania. I was driving my daughter's car, which uses the lowest level of gasoline, and I paid $1.99 a gallon. You have not seen that in California. But this generally is a good thing, because when you lower the price of petroleum, one of the things you do is everything that petroleum is in should cost a little less. And the result of that fact is that to poor people, that represents an increase in their spending ability, because there's lower prices for the things using petroleum. We are a poor area. The Inland Empire is not a wealthy part of the United States or of California, so that is a benefit to us to have had this happen. Now, this is my favorite chart because I do a lot of foreign travel. And it should be your favorite chart, because if you look at the labels in your clothing, the odds are nothing that you're wearing was made in the United States. If you look at your household appliances, very little of that made in the United States. If you go to Walmart or Costco or any of those types of companies, most of what you're looking at are imported goods. Now, this is a chart of the value of the dollar. This is 100. We sort of measure, if you take a ruler and call 100 normal. You could see the dollar got incredibly strong back in 02. It then dove down to very low levels. And that basically means that anything we buy in this period of time from the rest of the world was more expensive because our dollar wasn't worth very much. But you see at the end here, it took off. So what happened? Well, there's where it is now. There's where it was about a year ago. What happened to the value of the dollar? It went up 23.6%. So what? Well, you're in an international business class. Let's take one of the things I love. This is a bottle of Montrachet. Montrachet is a French white burgundy. Typically, a year ago, that bottle cost $4,000. So when I said to my wife, I want to buy a bottle of Montfrechet because I'm a great wine drinker, she said, you're out of your mind. Well, because the dollar got stronger, for us in the United States, that bottle would now only cost $3,237, which means it's $763 cheaper. Not because the French changed the price, it is simply because of the relationship of our currency to the euro. So I then went back to my wife and said, you know, can I have a bottle? She'd, hell no. So I'm now divorcing her. But the fact is, virtually everything we buy from the rest of the world has gone, is on the process of going down about 24%, which means imports through the ports of LA and Long Beach, which are huge drivers to our local economy, are going to be accelerating, but exports, because everything we make is 24% cheaper to the rest of the world, that cuts that off. Because we're too expensive. So if you're an importer or a consumer that uses import goods, this is a good thing. If you're a manufacturer who wants to sell stuff to the rest of the planet, you've got a problem right now. Now, another important metric from the rest of the world is consumer confidence, or not the rest of the world, to the economy. That is, how do we think about the economy? Do we feel good about it? Do we feel bad about it? We measure that again on a scale of 100. We can see back here in March of 2009, if you had a ruler that 100 was normal, we were down at 21.9, which meant we were really depressed about the economy, and with good reason, because we were in a deep recession. You can see that it starts to go up, but very slowly it goes up, declines. Every time it declined was when Congress was in session. Then it goes up, declines, because they kept doing crazy things. By the way, they're sort of setting up to do crazy things in the next month, so we'll see whether or not we decide to not pay our bills or whatever, because that's the kind of fights that go on in Washington. That's one of the reasons why, like I said, I hate everybody. So, but look where we are now. We're over the blue line. So we are feeling pretty good about the economy right now, which is a good thing. Because if you're going to buy a house, if you're going to buy a car, if you're going to buy consumer durables, which means washing machines or furniture or anything like that, you better be confident, otherwise you're not going to do it. So this is a positive again for the economy. It really helps our area because part of what we're dependent on are the sale of homes, particularly the building and sale of new homes, which is the sector that died back in 2009, 10, 11, 12, and is only now just starting to come back. If you listen to your own selves talk, or if you've talked to your parents or your grandparents, the fact their housing prices decayed so much scared the heck out of them, and a lot of people virtually lost their houses. We had very, very bad metrics in that case. So this is a help to that. Now, so the U.S. economy for us, pretty darn good shape. You can think of it as the ocean of forces in which we have to swim. And they're going in the right direction fundamentally for Southern California. For us, imports are a lot more than exports, so that's a good thing in terms of the price of the dollar, value of the dollar. For other areas, that's not the case. Now, what about our state, California? Well, if you were looking back in 2009, what you found was that this state, if you go down here, 1999, we were at the same level of jobs back in 2009 that we were in 1999. So we lost every job created during the early 2000s. They were all gone. Now, subsequently, we've now started growing, and you can see that we're now at a record level in the state. So the state is now firing on all cylinders again. When we look at that, in 08 to 10, which is this particular recession year, we lost 1,066,400 jobs in California. Catastrophic, and a lot of that was in the Inland Empire. Inland Empire, we'll see in a minute. Over 10% of that was lost in these two counties where you live. Now, what do we gain back? 1,942,000 between 2011 and 2015, this period in here. So where are we? We've added back 82% more jobs than we lost. So we're in, as a state, in much better shape, which again is good news. If we look, by the way, if we look at this, you see three recessions. Recession one, 1991 to 1993. What is that? The end of the Cold War. The Berlin Wall comes down. Because the Berlin Wall comes down, what ends up happening is we cut back on defense. Where is defense? Southern California. So we get clobbered. We lost 500,000 jobs in Southern California. This is recession number two, called the dot-com meltdown, when everybody was investing in dot-com stocks, and they got crazy. Notice every time something happens, it's because of over-dependence on something and a bit of craziness. We got crazy. We went into a recession, mostly in Northern California. And then, of course, the Great Recession that everybody got clobbered by. So that's the California picture. Again, for us, a pretty good picture. This is, again, some of the forces that affect us here in the Inland Empire, which brings us down to San Bernardino and Riverside counties. Now, what's going on here? This is the picture going back to 1984. You will notice two of the recessions are missing in terms of job loss. You don't see job loss with the end of the Cold War. Norton Air Force Base closed in San Bernardino. George Air Force Base closed in the high desert. Here in this area, if you go down to the corner of Haven and Foothill, that great big building there on the corner, that building was full of aerospace operations. It went out of business. The owner went from being worth $15 million to going bankrupt in 1 year. I knew him very, very well. He had things like, you know, the Porsche Gullwing, not the Porsche, the Mercedes Gullwing, and all these specialized cars, lost everything in that period of time. Still, we gained jobs, very few, but we did not go negative. Here's dot-com, it barely affected us. We were booming along, adding over 50,000 jobs, dropped to 41 into the 30s, but then jumped back to 61. So that recession didn't really hurt us. This did. Now, to put this in historical perspective, if you go back to when I started teaching, which would be to take the chart over about here, it would be blue all the way. There was never a downturn. End of the moonshot stuff and all that, none of that caused us to go negative. That year is the first time I had to give a speech where I was talking about job losses in the Inland Empire. And then, of course, it got really bad here where we lost 80,000. So what happened through this period? Now, we're now coming out of it. If you look here, what do you see? There is 2011, then 2012, 2013, and each of these last two, over 50,000. What's going on in 2015, the year we're in now? Another 50,000. What's the forecast that I've made preliminary for next year? This is what I get paid the big bucks to do. It looks like about 57,000, because virtually everything is firing on all cylinders, and housing is coming back, housing development, which was missing. So the result of that is you now look like you're going to have the four strongest years in the history of the Inland Empire in terms of job growth. For those of you in college right now, that's a really good sign that when you come out, there may actually be something to do. If you were talking to classes 4 years ago, I would not have been able to say that. They never invited me over to this college to talk about it. They were trying to fool their students, I suspect. So there you go. We've had three straight years of good job growth, and now we've got a fourth. Now, from 2011 to 2016, that P is preliminary, that's my forecast, what's going on? If I'm right, we will have added 250,000 jobs in this period. We only lost 142,933. So by the end of the next year, we should be up 107,000 jobs more than we lost during the recession. This year, we're already up just short of 50,000. So we're out of the hole and we are growing. In this area, which is one of the ones that was hurt the most in the entire country. Just to put it in context of how we're doing, what do you see? Los Angeles in 2014 added 96,500 jobs. How did the Inland Empire do? It added 53,100. So who's next? San Francisco, San Mateo, and then Silicon Valley. So we're actually adding more jobs than those two enormously powerful Northern California economies. This, by the way, is historically what I've always seen in this particular region. We've always had that kind of growth, except during this crazy period that, quite frankly, people are now inviting my wife over, and I'm very happy. Now, what's happened to unemployment rates? Well, let's look notice how closely the national and the Inland Empire tracked together in the early 2000s. Then we started getting higher than at any point here until the worst in 2010. We're way up here. The country's down there. That's a 5% difference. We were way out of line. Well, we've been coming down, the country's been coming down, and in June, which is what these numbers are, we were at 6.5, the country was at 5.5. The country's come down a little more. The problem you have with these kind of numbers is if you ever listen to an economic report on television, they'll always say the unemployment rate in the U.S. was X. That is a seasonally adjusted number. What does that mean? Well, I'll talk to the press a lot. And let's say it's December and the unemployment rate is really, really low. And they'll say, wow, the unemployment rate went down. I said, no, Christmas happened. Then they'll get to December and they'll call up and they say, to January, and they'll say, my God, the unemployment rate went up. Yeah, Christmas is over. So seasonally adjusted, we take that out. We have formula that we can use to adjust for the fact that that's what's going on. So seasonally adjusted, this number was probably about 5.3. But the unadjusted number, which is just a raw figure that doesn't allow for the decent seasons, you've got 6.5 versus 5.5, because our numbers are always unadjusted. We don't do that in the regions across the state of California. So we're in a lot better shape even on that. Now, let's talk about issues that you have to keep in mind as you think about where you live. This is a chart for those of you who are under 18, which is probably few of you, but for your siblings and friends who are under 18, 25.4% are living in poverty in this region. Now stop and think what that means. It means before they ever get to school, they're already behind the eight ball because they're in families that are poor. Poor means a family of four at this particular point in 2013 living on less than $24,000, which is roughly $2,000 a month, which you really can almost not survive on. One quarter of the children doing that, 18% of everybody was in fact in poverty in this region. This is probably the most important single issue facing the Inland Empire, and it is one that you hear almost nothing about. You hear tons about, oh, we've got to take care of the environment. It is the most important issue that we face. With all due respect, in this region, that kind of vocabulary and that kind of statement is nuts. And I will show you why in a minute. By the way, you will understand as I talk, I have no opinions about anything. Now, let's talk about how a local economy like ours operates. First of all, you've all seen Clint Eastwood movies. Let's go back to an old cowboy movie. And you have a gold mining town. What goes on there? These guys dig up gold. What do they do with it? They ship it away because you can't do anything with it. And what do they get for that? Money. So now they have money that can support them. Now what do gold miners need to have? Well, first of all, they need food and tools. So you have a general store. The general store only exists because the money came to the miners. Take away the miners, and that's part of a ghost town. So the general store is simply part of what comes about because the gold miners brought in the money. Now, phase two, second thing that happens. What else do they need? Well, they need entertainment. So we have the saloon. The people who work at the saloon, the bartender back there, this whole activity is what we call secondary tier. It's this same money being used second, third time inside the little town. Now, what else do miners need? Well, I used to run a casino, so they have some other needs, but I probably just got your professor fired. But the fact is, the whole secondary tier of activity only exists because of the gold mine. So the key for our economy is, what are the gold mines? Now let me give you an example of the town where I was running the casino. The town was dying. It was in the middle of nowhere in central Nevada, a little town called Ely. The economy was dying. It was an old mining town. The mine had dried up. The town was down to 58 people. The only people that were left in town were people that were trying to escape reality like me. But I couldn't make money with the casino because the economy wasn't large enough. So we needed to increase the size of the economy. So what I did was I talked to a guy across the street and I said, are there any prisons up in Carson City, which was the capital of Nevada? And he said, yeah, there's three up this year. And I said, well, why don't we get one for Ely? And they said, we've never been able to do that. And I said, okay. So I called up some friends in Sacramento where I have a lot of contacts. And I said, who's the top lobbyist in Carson City? It was a guy named Charlie Bell. And so I said to my friend, do you know a guy named Charlie Bell in Las Vegas, which is where his office was? Because he represented the casinos in Las Vegas with the legislature, which made him a lot of clout. He said, actually, yeah, he's in my stake. I said, what's a stake? Well, he was a Mormon, and stakes are the way they've organized the church. And so we drove down to see Charlie Bell, and I said, excuse me, do you do deals on the side? He said, yeah. I said, what's a prison going to cost Ely? He said, I can do it for 25 grand, provided I get the publicity that I did it after the fact. So we said, done. So we got back to Ely, and I said, look, call the town fathers together and invite me. Now, I'm an outsider. This is a very closed little town, so I get invited. So we're having a meeting, and we're saying, you know, with 25 grand, we can get the thing. And they're all saying, yes, 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 yes. Well, I was in the casino business. I had two other competitors, and I talked to them. So at a critical moment, I reached down, and I picked up a bag and poured $9,000 in $100 bills into the middle of the table. I said, now that's the casino share. Where's yours? They all signed checks, put them in the middle. By the time we walked out of that room, we had the 25 grand. We hired Charlie Bell. We got a medium security prison for Ely, secured the economic base. Why? Because that prison was the equivalent of a gold mine. It brings all this money in. You need guards. You have laundry. You have all sorts of things. you know, if people escape, they don't want to hang around, they want to leave. So it was really, that's economic strategy in its rawest form. By the way, we lost the casino because the time between when the prison opened and when we needed to pay our bills was too strong, so we had to leave. That's beside the point. That's why I came back and did Pioneer Takeout. All right, here's what the gold mines are for us. What are they? Well, first of all, logistics. All these big buildings around here, these buildings are all handling cargo in one way or another. So that is logistics. Huge driver for us. Brings in an enormous amount of money. Second, construction when it's active, particularly residential construction. That's the thing that caused the recession when that piece of the gold mine got turned off. Third, medical. Why? Well, think about if you go to the doctor, generally it's paid for by either insurance or Medicaid or Medi-Cal or Social Security, Medicare, all of those things. So the money comes in from the outside world very much like with the gold mine. Manufacturing, a crucial piece of the puzzle, but not growing. Why? Because we're in California. Why? Because the legislature is stupid. I'll get into that in a minute. And then high-tech, high-end office work, things of that nature. This has not been a major part of our economy. It is starting to become one, particularly here in the west end of San Bernardino County and the west end of Riverside, and I'll show you why in a minute. So those are the potential gold mines that bring in the money from the outside world. They then cause the second tier. So you have consumer services, you have retailing, you have those sorts of activities that propel other types of work. So the money coming in here goes through that. You will often hear people in cities saying, oh, we need more retail. More retail does not drive the economy. It simply deals with money coming in from down here in the corner. Now, here is our big educational challenge for the kinds of companies we can have in the Inland Empire. Notice San Bernardino County, 2013, 47% of adults, 25 and over, had a high school or less education, period. They never walked on this campus or any campus like this. They didn't go to private training schools. They stopped. That's almost half the adult population of this county. Riverside is slightly better at 45.7, not all that much better. If you talk to people in Riverside, they tend to say, oh, San Bernardino's horrible and we're great. With all due respect, neither one of them are doing very well. The worst is the Central Valley. You might, why the inland part of California? What you're looking at here is a north-south line, almost the San Andreas Fault. If you're to the west, the counties are doing pretty well. If to the east, the counties are catastrophic. What is going on here? This is about housing prices. What this is about is in the inland part of the state, housing or rents are lower. Why is that the case? Because NIMBYs on the coast have essentially stopped practically any new housing development using CEQA, the California Environmental Quality Act, for a purpose that it was never intended for, to stop housing building. And the result is to basically take the marginally educated, who tend to be somewhat worse off economically, and force them to migrate inland. That is why you get this picture. The wobbler is LA County. It's got some really high end, but some low end. And then look at the expanded Bay Area. Nothing like the rest of the state.
Dr. Husing.
Yeah.
Can you explain NIMBY for us?
NIMBY. Not in my backyard. Basically, you want to put up a affordable housing project in my neighborhood? Screw you. I'm going to get this stopped. All I've got to do is spend $175 to file a lawsuit under CEQA, and I've just held the project up for probably 2-3 years. And people do this serially, and there are lawyers who specialize in it because it's a cash cow. It's how they make their income, so they file against every project. So CEQA is in fact a purpose, very good. Use, a disaster. Will the legislature change it? So far, no. Why? Because the environmental community doesn't want anybody to touch it. You will learn that I am not green. I own a BMW 435i, and I am proud of the fact it does 155. Don't get in front of me on the road. Now, if you have a Tesla, not a Tesla, I can keep up with them. No, if you have a Toyota Prius, get out of my way. I swear they take all of you and put you in school and teach you to drive like that. Now, this is an issue that we really face in our area. These are terrible numbers. The question is, what the hell are we going to do about it? I've been looking at this get worse over my 50 years of studying this stuff, and so far we have not fixed it. It's in fact gotten worse throughout that entire time. So this is an issue that we really face, where the community colleges are absolutely crucial. Now, let's talk about K-12 education, which is a key to this. K-12 education, how much, we had $51,000, we've had that large amount of job growth that I showed you, over 200,000 jobs through this year. What's the biggest share of it? Well, it certainly isn't K-12. From 2011 to 2015, 9,000 jobs added. They were negative for a while as we ran into budget difficulties. 5% of job growth in the state. If we look at the median pay for people working in K-12, $41,557. People working in logistics make more money than this. Now you notice I said median pay. I did not say average or mean. We use the median because all you do is take all the numbers, stack them up, cut them in half, and the number in the middle is the median. It is not pulled up because somebody that's working in teaching make $10 million. Whatever the number values are doesn't count. It's just what number is dead in the center. And so that's the dead center for K-12 median pay. Not that good, though it is with another worker in the family working in retailing or low income would get you to the middle class. There is higher education, 1% of growth. We need that to be much more than that. In that 2011 to 2015 period. $60,000 pay, much better. So if you want to borrow some money, talk to your professor, they're all rich. Now, healthcare, second major sector for us. What about it? Well, it's a very dynamic sector. In that 2011 to 2015 period, it has added 353,000 jobs. It should be higher than this. Why isn't it higher? Because the Affordable Care Act has been so controversial that people in healthcare have been somewhat reluctant to expand. Now that it's gone to the Supreme Court and been upheld, it will probably start growing faster because, in fact, it is increasing demand. Increased demand, you tend to see more hiring go as a consequence of that. This sector, 57,443. What's interesting about healthcare is a year and a half ago now, I had spinal surgery. So one of the things I did was I talked to virtually everybody I came in contact with, and I asked them, what's your education? Where'd you go to school? How far did you go? And what was fascinating, and I probably interviewed 25 people. We're talking about the lady at the desk that gave me my first appointment. We're talking about the lady that walked me down the hall to go meet the surgeon. We're talking about the MRI tech that was taking pictures of me. We're talking about the nurse that did my pulse, the one that did my EKG, all that kind of stuff. Far and away, most of the people working in the sector. The only ones with college degrees were the two nurses, who were the surgeon's nurse and the anesthesiologist. I got that out before they knocked me out. and then the two the surgeon and the anesthesiologist himself. Only four out of all of the people I came in contact with. In fact, one of the interesting stories was one of them that I met very early in the process. She was doing the EKG. I said, what's your background? She says, well, I was living in a car 3 years ago. And I went to a training program with the help of the county. I got my nurse's aide certificate, and that got me this job. And I said, are you going to stay at this level? She said, I don't know. I saw her again a year later, and she now was up a notch because she was taking more courses, because now that she was in the system, she understood she could do this stuff. And she was now on her way up because she was taking more training and moving up the skill ladder within that field. So that 57,000 applies to a very large number of people with AA degrees and certificates and schooling at private schools. Interestingly enough, last in 2014, none of the job growth was in hospitals. They were the most skittish about what was going on with the Affordable Care Act. The great majority was in physicians and dentists and other outpatient offices, which is basically the trend in medicine. I had surgery on my back, right? You'd think I'd be in the hospital for a while. I was in the hospital for precisely 24 hours, and they kicked me out. Actually, I gave a speech the following Tuesday. Fortunately, it was at a hospital, and it was a whole audience full of nurses in front of me. So if anything happened, there were plenty of people to take care of me. The funny part of that was, as you hear, I have some rather specific points of view. And I just laughed at one point and said, look, I'm on my meds. I can say anything I want. Okay. Now the third most important, or a third part and the most important sector in our region. I laughingly say that the state of California, the legislature did one thing really right. What did they do? They put California on the West Coast. I will give them credit for that. The other thing was some good decisions made down in Long Beach and Los Angeles at the harbors, where back in the early part of the last century, they took all the oil out from underneath San Pedro Bay. What happened? The bay was like a bubble, with oil holding the bottom up. You take the oil out, the bottom sank. So what did you end up with? Deep water harbors on the West Coast, just in time for Chinese and Asian trade to need deep water houses, deep water harbors because of the large size of the ships that were coming in. So clearly some very good long-term thinking. Now, the goods come in through these harbors. You see all the containers on the deck of that ship, and containers here, containers there. Containerized shipping entering the United States, 40% of it comes in through LA and Long Beach harbors. Who's second place? Who cares? It is so far behind, it doesn't count. It's actually New York, New Jersey, and it's like 15%. So overwhelmingly, international trade in containers enters these ports. Now, these are the few that, where do they go? Some of it goes right on trains and leaves. That's immediately leaves the region and goes across the United States. These ports serve virtually the entire United States. Yeah?
I'm sorry, going back to container ships, do you say Los Angeles and San Diego?
No, Los Angeles and Long Beach.
Okay, thanks.
San Diego has a minor role in what they call break bulk cargo, which is non-containerized, and then so does Port Hueneme, which is a port over Ventura County. It handles a lot of automobiles and, for some reason, bananas. How this stuff happens, nobody really knows. Now, so a lot of it goes onto trains and leaves, but a lot of it goes into trucks. A significant number of those trucks end up out here, and you see a truck carrying a container. Most of those containers are 40 feet, which is called two TEUs. A TEU is a 20-foot equivalent container. It is the measurement we use for containers, and the standard today is 40 feet, so it's two. If you see an extended container, That is 53 feet, and those are used on landside. Once the containers get here, they take the cargo out of the 40s, put them in the 53s, and the 40s go back to the ports, because they go back to Asia. Now, this is what's going on at the moment, and this chart is a little bit out of date. You can see the Chinese trade. These are 20-foot equivalent containers. Goes from 4.8 in 2000 to a record 8.2 million. It then falls off with the Great Recession, works its way back. This bar is now ever so slightly above 7.8. It's barely above, but the most recent data, which I didn't have a chance to put in here, puts it slightly above that. So this year it is running at now the third highest ever. That's good for our economy because we handle this stuff. Exports, on the other hand, I told you about the value of the dollar. You can see exports growing, fall off during the recession, grow. Now the value takes off in dollar takes off in value, and you see the loss of the trade there on the export side. And there's a message here of what I'm doing in with all these charts and stuff. As an economist, I'm a little bit like a detective. I'm trying to figure out what the heck is going on in a really complex economy. And so what I'm trying to do is find evidence and combining that with theory to understand what the evidence is telling me. So when I say in theory the value of the dollar goes up, you should have a decline in exports and an increase in imports. Precisely what I'm showing you here, there's the decline. As I said, this is now over 7.8. It'll probably end up at 7.9, maybe not quite 8.0. And the reason for that is we had a labor slowdown at the ports in January that slowed down all the numbers. Otherwise, I'm sure it would have hit 8.0 this year. By the way, if you live anywhere near a train track, where you see trains with cargo on them going by, right now there's a lot of it. Why? That's the inventory for Christmas coming out of the harbors and going across the country by rail, and then there's the stuff, of course, that just stays here. The other thing that's happening, let me ask you as a class a question. Who in here did not buy something online for Christmas last year? Raise your hand. Several of you have to give up your U.S. citizenship. The fact is, we're changing what we're doing, and you guys are the ones generally who are causing it to happen. Now, turn it around, and let's say you're Macy's. All of a sudden, people aren't coming to the store, or if they are, they're coming and they're looking at their cell phone and going, oh, I can buy this cheaper if I go online. So the net result of that is to change the whole dynamic of retailing. And the result of that is Macy's, for instance, is no longer going to be building big stores. In fact, they're laying people off in their stores. Why? Because they realize that the future is no longer in malls. So things like Ontario Mills or things like Victoria Gardens will be a thing of the past, not of the future. So what's the future? What the future is million square foot warehouses like this one with Amazon.com in it. There's another picture of it. They're called fulfillment centers. And what they are is a very large number of people working, trying to get you your stuff in 24 hours after you order it. A complete shift in the retail dynamic. By the way, if you're a city and one of these is in your town, you end up getting all the retail sales taxes from any sale in California, which means instead of not wanting warehouses, all of a sudden they should be wanting warehouses because they get a lot of retail sales off. The heck with the mall, get one of these. In fact, one or two or three of these. Well, just to put it in perspective, Ontario, 37% of their city retail sales taxes come out of their industrial zone. That is far and away more than they get off Ontario Mills. It's far and away more important to them to have the industrial in the city now. That's a complete change in dynamic. This is how fast it's growing. Let's say you have a savings account. How would you like to be making 15% a year on your interest rate on your savings account? That's how fast e-commerce is growing. 15% compounded. It was much faster in the beginning. You see the recession, and it sort of leveled off somewhere between 15 and just under 20% growth every year. This is what the story. Yes, ma'am.
Sorry, so is that kind of what we're seeing in, like, South Fontana, where all these warehouses?
Absolutely.
Is that the hopes of all this?
It's not just the hope, it's what's going on. Yeah. There's two things that go into the warehouses. The cargo that's stopping here, being held, and then shipped across the country, that's generally related to the ports. And then more and more, it's e-commerce facilities, and the cities are really very happy to be starting to see some of that stuff. There are exceptions to that. There's a real controversy about logistics because it's trucks. And trucks have diesel. And diesel causes pollution. And then people got sick. And so there's a real fight here going on about that. I'll describe in a minute. This is really all about the Inland Empire, though. Where are the new industrial facilities along the line she's talking? 82% of them are being built in the Inland Empire. Second place, LA County. Who cares? We have eight times as much as LA County. Why? They haven't got any land. I have this theory called dirt theory that says you want to know where the fastest growing place is? Go find the dirt. If there's any dirt, that's the fast growing place. By the way, people get really angry with me in Riverside because they think they're going to be referred to as the dirt people. Not only are we building a lot, 19.8 million, that was under construction in June, so that was not available, but in the four quarters ended in June, we occupied 7.4 million net new space. That's companies moving here and bringing jobs. Hugely important. So you see, there's the 17.4, they're on at the end. You can see it got all the way up to 48 million square feet occupied in 1 year. That was a little excessive. It then fell off because we're running out of space. We then get into the recession. It bounces back up, and we begin running out of space again. And now it's sort of, we're probably going to be seeing about 17 million occupied each year because that's all we've got being built new. This is the vacancy rate. It's down to 3.6%. In this business, 7 is normal. 3.6 means there isn't any. Now, how's this sector doing? The top number, 43,803 jobs added in that 2011 to 2015 time frame. 23%, one out of every four jobs, almost, being created in this particular field. By the way, remember, these are gold mines. If 23% of the jobs being created are directly in this field, think of the people working at Stater Brothers and people working at Ontario Mills or at any other shopping center. What you're seeing is probably something like about 35 or 40% of all jobs in our area in growth coming out of this sector. Hugely important. What do we have? Room for those big facilities. Now, you're almost out of it in the West End. You're almost out of it in Fontana. You're out of it in Rialto. They're converting the airport to be able to have this now. It's pretty much in San Bernardino and Redlands. Redlands just ran out with the last deal. So it's going now out the 60 down towards Paris. And then there is a bloodbath political fight going on in Moreno Valley about this stuff. So, and there the battle is jobs versus environment. What's this pay? The pay here is median $44,000. Better than K-12 school teachers. Now, that doesn't mean you start at that. The fact is you probably start around $12.50 an hour. $12.50 an hour for no education to speak of, no particular ability in the field, isn't bad to start, but you can work your way up because there's 155 different occupations that you can engage in the field. To show you how controversy ends up in my field, all the data that you see me using down here at the bottom is source. Where does it come from? I don't make these numbers up. They happen to be mostly California Employment Development Department or U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics, with me then doing the calculations based on it. The calculations I did here was just to add together the numbers. Now, there are people that don't like trucks. So they then go off and do their own studies because they don't like what the official data is saying. One of those is University of California at Riverside in their sociology department. Another one is a geographer from USC. So what have they done? They've looked at the bottom five occupations, what they pay, and said, that's the sector. If I did that with the top five occupations, they'd try and have me killed. But the fact is, what are they doing? They're biasing the study by what they're studying and then saying, oh, look, this is awful. Both of them are very closely tied up with organized labor who wants to, in fact, unionize all of these jobs, which at the current time are not. But don't think just because it's an academic institution that what they're doing is, in fact, fair and balanced. They're about as fair and balanced on the left as... what's that horrible channel? I don't even...
Fox
is on the right. Okay. Now, let's talk about pollution because it's a crucial issue. The major pollutant coming out of diesel is PM2.5, which is fine particulate matter that if it gets into your lungs can cause asthma, can cause cancer, lots of different things. Back in 2001, the worst split case in Southern California was Riverside Rubidoux. Absolute worst area. 120 days over the federal standard. Look at where it was in 2014. 5.3 days. Now, how did it get from there to there, down 95.6%, when in fact what occurred in that time was 240 million square feet of new facilities occupied with all the trucks that brought? Now, how did that happen? And the answer is, they've changed the technology of the diesel engine. And they specifically did it in 2007, and those engines are now required on all trucks going to the ports or going to a rail yard where they transfer the equipment. So, the fact is you have a difficulty here, and I come down on the side of the logistics and the jobs because they help with poverty. Now, let's move to the next source, manufacturing. This is our problem in manufacturing in California. The U.S. from January 2010 to June 2015 created 875,000 manufacturing jobs. We've had a manufacturing boom going on in the country. California's only created, round figures, 35,000. Only 4% of the national total, and we have the biggest base of manufacturing. It just isn't growing. Why not? Because of the California state legislature. All of the rules and regulations they've put in place have essentially said to the manufacturing industry, if you're not in California, don't come. If you're in California and you have a multi-state operation, put your growth in the other states, or possibly in some cases, you may want to leave. Now, just to put this in perspective, as young people, I'm sure most of you think making a green environment is absolutely the thing to do. Well, let me show you the effect of what you're doing, because one of the facts that you need to look at, and this is where economics is called the dismal science, that is, what are the unintended downside risks? Well, 33% renewables is the current rule. that we've put in place, and what's it done to the cost of electricity in California? It has shoved it out to there. That is the price for industrial electrical rates, a similar bar for households, a similar bar for commercial operations. Let's take a nearby state, Nevada. That's the little bar for Nevada. This is 158% higher than Nevada. Want to know one of the reasons why Tesla didn't make their car here, even though it was designed here and subsidized here? Because of numbers like that. The second most expensive state in the country is North Dakota, and we are 50%, not quite 50%, more expensive in electricity. These costs matter, and companies make decisions. Now, does it hurt the companies? No. Who does it hurt? They're workers who never see their jobs created. So you have a Democratic administration going nuts on renewables. They just passed a law, 50% now for renewables, which is going to take that and shove it over to this. Is this the thing they used to spy on you? To shove it out here someplace and make it even more uncompetitive and hurt potentially marginally educated workers even more, which is the base of their own party. Now you raise these objections, and what did they say? They don't want to talk about it. I've said this directly to GoBiz, which is the governor's operation which looks at these sorts of issues. And I said, hey, what are you doing? You are a Democratic administration, and you are basically saying to the poor, we're going to keep you there by cutting off access to the jobs to get you out of poor, out of being poor. What does he say? Well, output is up. So I said, fine, output is up, but no jobs. And you're really proud of that? With all due respect, I don't know who you people are. And that was the reason, frankly, I'd left the Democratic Party. But I hate Republicans, so that was a problem. Now, when you put all the rules and regulations and cost structure together, and you go out and you talk nationally to companies and ask them, how do you rank California? And the answer is 50th. These are chief executives. 50th is not best. What it says, they don't want to be here. If they're here, they're here reluctantly. If they're not here, they're not coming. In fact, the economic development director of the state of Utah said his greatest ally in recruiting companies is the California state legislature and the governor. What about small businesses? Well, they rank California 50th. So we've got a problem here in job creation that can help poorer people get out of that particular problem when you're shutting that off. How's manufacturing doing? It's added 4% of our jobs. Notice this was 23, this is 4%. So it's growing a little bit, basically because the country's growing, but it's not growing very well. Pay, $49,138, pretty darn good pay. By the way, if you want to quit what you're doing right now and make some money, go become a welder. Welders are starting between $50,000 and $100,000. And they're also, by the way, looking for women. Why? Because women can do precision work more than the guys. They want to be big and sloppy. The women are very good at the minutiae. Now, construction. This gets us pretty much to the housing industry. That shows you notices of default. Notices of default are the first step in the foreclosure process. You can see it, it peaked here at just over 12,000 foreclosures announced in 1 month. This, in June, it was 878. I've got the August number, and it's down to 600 and something. Very few foreclosures now. That's pretty much gone. You can see this whole period of time is much more relaxed after we got out of craziness when people did stupid things and then lost their houses. What's happened to prices? Existing homes in 2015, forget that number, it's supposed to be in a range, peaked there, dropped over 60% to 155,000. They're now back up 60%. Unfortunately, going up 60 from a low number isn't the same as dropping 60 from a big number. So it's back to 283. If you look at here and you run out and go down, we're back to the 2003-2004 level before craziness hit us all. We're still 27% above the peak, or below the peak, I mean, but a lot of these houses have been lost. That was when people were doing liar's loans. You know, you went into to borrow money and they said, I want to buy a $750,000 house in Rancho Cucamonga. They said, fine. What do you make? Well, I make $500,000 a year. Oh, that's great. Have you got any documents? No, I don't. Well, what do? I'm the greeter at Walmart. Fine, here's the loan. Well, those are the ones that are lost. Now, one of the reasons our area keeps growing is, as I said, because of dirt. And dirt shows up here in the cost of housing built on dirt. One of the first things that happens when an area grows up is people move into it because they can afford to live there. Prior to the time that the houses are built, they wouldn't even consider going that far. I remember when everybody was landing in Ontario in the late 70s, and everybody was a commuter to LA. Then it all happened in Fontana and Rialto and Colton. Where are they now? The high desert. How do you know? Go take a look at the 15 freeway in the morning or in the evening. So that's usually how the cycle starts. People move for housing. $296,000 is the middle-priced house, the median, in the Inland Empire. Now, it's 512 in San Diego, 517 in L.A., and not quite 700,000 in Orange County. Why do people move inland? Because they save those numbers. They save 216,000 versus San Diego, 221 versus L.A., and 402,000 versus Orange. Now, to put this in perspective, I just sold my mother-in-law's house because she had to move into assisted living. A 1,000 square foot house, so a little tiny house, in the takeoff pattern for Long Beach Airport, which means JetBlue comes in over her house and practically takes the roof off. That house sold for $485,000. $15,000 below half a million. We put it on the market. We were going to put it on for $445,000. Then our real estate guy says, now we had to try $555,000. He called back a week later and says, you know, a couple of sales came in. Why don't we try $565,000? So I said, why don't we put it on for $575,000, which gives us some room to come down. He says, good idea. Two people came on in 3 days for $475,000. One of them kicked in another 10 grand and went off at 485. And we're sitting there dizzy. So I talked to people in LA, say, that's crazy. And they said, no, it's normal. And that's what's going on in LA County. But it's why people will move here. They don't have a choice. They have to if they're going to either rent or they're going to buy. Which is why our area always has heavy levels of population growth. This puts it in affordability terms. In our area, with our fairly low income, 47% of our population can afford our middle-priced house, that $296,000 house. It was way up over 70 during the recession. In LA, only 31%, and their incomes are about the same as ours, but their prices are higher. In Orange, it's only 22%, and that's the highest income county in Southern California, yet only 22% of the people who live there can afford their middle-priced house. That is why Rancho Cucamonga is growing again. Upland, Chino Hills, Eastvale, Chino, Norco, Corona. That's that migration going on. We finally have seen a blip now in demand for housing. You can see that it was decaying, mostly because we were running out of houses. Now, all of a sudden, there's a big jump. And that's good news. Hopefully when I get the point for this summer, which I'll get in about 2 weeks, that number will be higher yet. Hopefully. Now, construction is finally joining the league again, so what do you see? 21,427 jobs, 11%. Median income, 51.9. Very good pay. Like I said, you want a job to make some money, give up college and go become a construction worker. The only problem is 5 years from now, you'll probably be unemployed again. It's in cycles like this. Then we get to the office-based part of the economy, the last of those major things down in the left corner. This is the kind of work that engineering, legal and accounting, police and fire, healthcare, science and information, even film and commercials going on out here. These are jobs that pay very, very well. There's also a lot of office backup to them, which helps a lot as well. These are the median income or median housing prices in the West End in March. They've all gone up from this. But you can see they're all in the 400s to over 500 in the West End. This is the kind of stuff that people who are well-educated or working in high-level technical jobs or are entrepreneurs in L.A., Orange, and San Diego, particularly in this case L.A. and Orange, this is where they're migrating. A little bit into Riverside, into Orange Crest and Woodcrest here at the south end of the city. There's some going on down in Temecula Murrieta out of San Diego. Market's not as strong. A little bit where I live in Redlands and Loma Linda, specifically because of Loma Linda University Medical Center and because of the University of Redlands and because of Esri, which is the big GIS company that's located in Redlands and has over 2,000 employees. So you've got some pretty good stuff there, but mostly this is a West End move. What's happened through 2013? We've increased the number of educated people by about three quarters from 2000 to 2013. The new numbers just came in and it's now at 75%. But even at that, only 20% of our residents have a bachelor's or higher. This makes it tough to compete for high-end employers. I get criticized a lot for talking a lot about blue-collar. Why? Because we have a blue-collar labor force, and those are the jobs we need. One of the people that I fight with most often is Ron Leverage, former mayor of Redlands, who's now at UCR, and Ron wants high-end economic strategies without a high-end labor force. And I just look at him and laugh. I said, if you want to have a high-end economic strategy, you've got to put it in the West End, not in Riverside. He said, we have the university. I said, I don't care. So there you go. Riverside, only 21% bachelor's and above. San Bernardino, only 19. And who are you competing with? L.A.? This number is San Diego, Orange, Ventura, and Santa Barbara. Look at the Bay Area, 40%. Here's a problem. This is a political problem. The political problem is these are the areas where blue-collar workers have been forced to move, these three over here, because of housing. Who sets California's agenda politically? The Bay Area, to a large extent, as well as the coastal counties of Southern California. That's where political power and income reside. This is where you get green. This is where you get poverty, and to the extent that green hurts poverty, the power structure is against where you live. The other diversity challenge we have is 48.9% Hispanic in the Inland Empire, white non-Hispanic 34.7%, African American and Asian and Pacific 7.0% and 6.5%. The Asian is growing faster than the African American. Those are going to be equal pretty quick here. Now, these are the high-end sectors that pay really well. Management and professions, 401. That's better than manufacturing. That's pretty good. Higher education. Then you have mining, which has almost no growth but no loss. But then you've got publishing and telecommunications, and our area is negative. And then federal and state and local government, which we'll talk about in a minute, but in the private sector, not really doing all that well. Median pay, very good. Our trouble is in getting companies is we have trouble competing for them. If I got you Microsoft to move down from Seattle tomorrow, we'd have to import their labor force. Office space related to this, soared, crashed, and is sort of coming back, but not doing all that well. 475 was the net absorption there. Vacancy was down to 7, which is really low. That was the lowest in the United States, with the exception of Bozeman, Montana, and Bakersfield, California. Hardly two of the more dynamic places in the country. Then we built a lot of space, and then the recession hit, and vacancies went up over 24%. They're working their way down finally now. But here in Rancho Cucamonga, 1 out of 4 square feet was vacant in all the office buildings around here. Education is key to this. Those are our four-year colleges. Here's all our community colleges. Then you have the K through 12. Those are the two county elected superintendents with all the systems they work with. And then we have some pretty good private sector schools. Not all of them, but some of them are pretty good. So that's the backbone to try and change the education dynamic. The financial sectors are important. Why? Because they're related to construction. As construction goes up, these numbers will take off. Because this is escrow, title, insurance, those sorts of activities. They've been somewhat dormant. They will take off again. What happened in the recession, a lot of these operations consolidated back into the coast. Median pay in them, 48 grand, pretty good. Finally and lastly, the secondary tier, 45% of all jobs are in that huge group of sectors, 45%. Median pay, under 30,000. By the way, 45% is good. Statewide, it's 55%. We do better because we have more blue-collar jobs than the rest of the state tends to have. Then the last thing we have is federal and state, which are negative. If you're in the school wanting to go be a planner or something in government, forget it. Those sectors are quite negative and probably will continue to be. Median pay is very good, but the jobs aren't growing. So finally, this is how we end up. My forecast for next year, 57,000 jobs is what I'm looking for. If this is of interest to you, that's my website, and I put this on there. So you can download it and have fun with it if you'd like to. Question in the corner.
So you think the Victorville area, with the, you know, you're talking about having a speed train going from Los Angeles?
Yeah. Actually, that was a client of mine.
You think that's going to boost Victorville's economy?
It could if, in fact, the Chinese money going into it actually works. It's not going from L.A., it's going from Victorville out, so the drive would be you would drive to Victorville, park your car there, and then take the train out to Las Vegas. It could help. Victorville right now isn't really in the recovery. It's part of the problem we have in the high desert of areas that aren't caught up here.
Can you guys wait a little bit before you pack? You guys, we have about 5 minutes. Thank you.
Yeah.
With all the, like you said, that people are migrating in, inwards, how does that affect the housing prices for those of us who are those people who aren't on the higher end of the scale of income and education? Because I know our rent just went up like another $50.
Part of the, we're not building housing very much in California. Therefore, prices are soaring. People are being forced to migrate inland, a lot of them to be renters. That's going to push your rent up. To the extent that we're able to respond to that by building new housing, then it will ameliorate some of that as people will come out to buy. But and also to the extent that we can build more rental properties as well, both of those two things. So that's sort of the way that market's working right now. Yes, ma'am.
Going back to the gas subject, why is it that in California, we, even though like the gas economy goes up and down, but in California
is always high.
Yeah, why is it?
The answer to that question is California's gas supply, the mixture that's allowed in our gas tanks because of dealing with air quality, is only really produced in refineries in California. There was an explosion in one of the plants up in the Bay Area, and so its production went way down. At the same time, there was an explosion in one of the plants in Southern California, down in the Carson area, so the production fell further. So you had a lack of supply of the specific gasoline that we use in California. That then caused the prices to be higher. Now, if you thought that was bad, the state legislature just had a bill that was going to say that 15 years from now, you'd have to cut all gasoline and all petroleum consumption in the state by 50%. Now, 15 years ago, 9/11 was 14 years ago. That wasn't that long ago. Imagine trying to cut all petroleum consumption by that amount in 15 years. Had that happened, those prices would have become astronomical. And fortunately, those of us that care more about poverty than we do about absolute environmental purity, which is the standard on the other side, talk to enough of the Democrats who come from poor districts, and they rebelled and said, wait a minute, these are my constituents you're hurting. It's the first time that message penetrated with that group of Democrats. And they yanked that out. They left in going to 50% on renewables, but they took that piece out. Because it would, like I said, the worst group of people on this stuff are our elected officials in the Capitol who don't represent their own constituents on a lot of these issues. Now, to be continued, that'll be brought back again, believe me.
Well, I'm going to hold off the questions. We need to give the students time to go to the next class.
Okay, sorry.
Thank you, Dr. Husing.
My pleasure.
Alec actually is going to present a gift on the behalf of the class to thank you for your time.
Oh, it's my pleasure. You can tell I get sort of worked up doing this.
This is on behalf of the Global Business class.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
I'm going to post this assignment on Moodle. It'll be there in the next 5 minutes, and it'll be due, uploaded to Moodle this time next week. And then I think you'll provide us with the PowerPoint slide.
It's in your computer.
Okay, great. I'll post the slides as well on Moodle. We'll have the video also on Moodle with Dr. Kuhn's permission, and I'll see you guys. Okay? Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Kuhn. Really, really fantastic.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.